Good evening. I hope you're all settled. Everybody got their coats off in case you get too warm? Good. A few little minor housekeeping announcements. Don't forget the Learned Owl is in the entryway selling Tracy's books and will later be in the rotunda at the reception for Tracy and further sell, and you can get your book signed then. Secondly, there are programs in the hall of all of our upcoming author and music programs. You might want to grab some. I'm told we have some pretty awesome programs. Third, don't forget there's a little box there back by the wall where you're welcome to make donations that help us defray the cost of bringing people in that are speakers or what have you. And I'm so glad to see you all tonight. I get to introduce you to one of my friends. In case you don't know, this is Tracy's third trip to Hudson, Ohio. And in those three trips, I've really gotten to know a wonderful person. I'm a little shocked, Tracy. I did not know, according to Wikipedia, the very first thing is FRSL. I had no idea what FRSL was until I looked it up. Do any of you? Joyce, where is Joyce? Do you know? Tracy is a fellow of the Royal Society of Literature, which is a pretty prestigious She has written numerous books, in case you are unaware, one of which might have something to do with Hudson, Ohio. There is a certain character, Belle Mills, who is in here, who actually did live in Hudson, Ohio. And Tracy and I got to know each other as she was doing research for this book. She is a phenomenal writer. She is world acclaimed. She is a wonderful person. She has ties to Ohio. She knows Ohio fairly well. She went to Oberlin, in case you don't know. So if any other fellow Obies are in the room, you can holler. She loves Oberlin, among other places. Tomorrow she will be in Toledo. She is driving. I've told her the weather gods will be fairly nice and she won't have to deal with too much snow between here and Toledo, right? And then the day after that, she's going to Cincinnati. So she's going to get a little warmer and less snow. And we told her to make sure to get Grater's ice cream. Yeah. Tracy is a phenomenal human being. I won't bore you, but she has numerous titles. She has written numerous titles. And most recently, she is now on the board of the Royal Library or the British Library. As in England, British Library. She hails from Washington, D.C. originally, but now she lives in London. So I told her Hudson's not the happening town that London is. But she did take a walk on our main street and sort of tootle around a little and see how it's changed. Without further ado, because you don't need to hear anything from me, you all need to hear it from her. Fellow friends and Hudsonites, please welcome my friend, and hopefully your friend soon, Tracy Chevalier.
Good evening. Thank you so much for coming out, and thank you, Gwen. For those of you who know Gwen, she's not someone you say no to, and she has a short list of writers she's trying to encourage to come here, and I feel like emailing those two writers who are on her short list, and just say, you know, just give in, because this battle is not going to finish until she wins the war, so just come. But I'm delighted to be back, my third time, as Gwen has said. I've always had a great reception, and there is, amazingly, I have now written two novels, not just one, but two novels set in Ohio, and I couldn't be more astonished by that than you probably are. And you're probably thinking, why are you going to Toledo? I actually asked to go to Toledo, and you'll know why in a minute, because the book is set right near Toledo. That was the first place I wanted to go. And they said, "Where do you want to go on your book tour?" And I said, "Toledo and Hudson." So you come in second place, but only geographically. So what I'm going to do tonight is to talk a bit about how I came up with the idea for this book, the two pillars as I see it, because half of the book is set. This is at the edge of the orchard. Half of the book is set in Ohio, and the other half is set in California. So there are sort of two things. There are two trees involved. There are two real people involved. And there's a movement between, because this, in some ways, is a book about movement. It's a book about migration, both of humans, of people, and also of trees. So I will talk about Ohio first, and then I will talk about California with a little bit of connecting tissue in between. So I'm going to talk and do three bits of reading, because I always like to read. I think that's my favorite part. I'll start by explaining why are there apples on this cover? How did that happen? My last book, as Gwen had, was The Last Runaway, which is set, if you've read it, set outside of Oberlin in a fictional Quaker community in 1850. And when I was doing research for that book, I was reading a whole lot of different books, and one of them was Michael Pollan's Botany of Desire. It's a book that was published probably 10, 15 years ago, and it's about our relationship with plants. So it's divided into four sections. There's a section on apples, potatoes, tulips, and marijuana. Yes. So it's quite a nice read. But I read the section on apples specifically because it was focusing on 19th century Ohio, and even more specifically on Johnny Appleseed. And I was merely reading it to glean details of everyday 19th century Ohio life. That's all I was reading it for. I wasn't reading because it was Johnny Appleseed or apples or any of that. But nonetheless, I started getting more and more fascinated because what Pollan does is he takes the myth of Johnny Appleseed, whose real name was John Chapman, and he cracks it open, and he strips off all of the things. Like, when you think of Johnny Appleseed, you think of healthy eating, and you think of the Disney movie where he's wandering around singing, and he goes barefoot, and he has a tin pot for a hat, and he talks to the animals, and he gives away seeds, apple seeds, and he says, "You must eat apples all the time. They're good for you, and you'll have a better, healthier life." And some of that is true. He did go barefoot quite a bit, and he was quite attuned to animals. He was vegetarian for the most part, and he slept outside a lot, and he went around in a canoe in early 19th century Ohio. Is by far the fastest way to get around. But what the myth obscured was that he was a businessman. That was what he was. He was doing it to make money. And really what he did was he figured out that settlers were going to be coming and settling in Ohio at the beginning of the 19th century. And he would go where he thought people would be coming in a few years. And he'd plant a nursery, preferably alongside a river, nursery of apple trees. Because if you were going to settle in Ohio in the 19th century, early 19th century, you had to commit to planting an orchard of 50 fruit trees within 3 years, because it was a sign that you were going to settle, you were going to stay. And Johnny Appleseed knew about this, so he'd plant a nursery, and when settlers would come, he would then sell them the apple trees. And so he was making money. It wasn't just out of the love of apples, although I suppose he did like them. And the most important thing that Pollan uncovered in all this is he explained something I had never really grasped. If you have a sweet apple, if you want to grow sweet apples, you really have to grow them from a tree that's been grafted from another sweet apple tree. If you eat an apple and it's sweet and you take the seed and you plant it, 9 times out of 10 that tree will grow up to produce sour apples, not sweet apples. So if you want a Golden Delicious, you have to graft it, which means taking a branch from an existing Golden Delicious and then grafting it onto a rootstock, it grows up and it produces Golden Delicious. Now, Johnny Appleseed didn't believe in grafting. He was part of a Christian sect called the Swedenborgians, and one of the things he didn't believe in was grafting. He said it goes against God's will. God wants those apple trees to grow up the way they will and produce what they will, and we don't want to tamper with it. So he insisted on planting seeds, and the apple saplings that he sold to people, by and large, produced sour apples, but they were very popular because it wasn't about eating. Ohioans were not eating sweet apples all the time. They were drinking. They were drinking cider. Not that cider we have now. What we call cider has no alcohol in it at all. This is hard cider. And not just that, but they then started making Applejack, which is a kind of, at the time, was a very rough apple brandy. And they drank this to sort of numb the effect of their difficult pioneer lives. And I had no idea. I was so amazed by this. So when I was reading it, I started forgetting about the details of daily Ohio life for the last runaway. I started thinking, apples, apple trees. This is fascinating. And I had this vision of this couple who have an argument over apples, and it gets worse and worse. One of them wants to grow sweet apples, graft them and grow sweet apples for eating. The other wants to grow sour apples for making cider to get through her tough life. And before you know it, I had this couple, James and Sadie Goodenough, and I thought, that's what I want to write. So I had to finish The Last Runaway first, but then I thought, wow, I've never written a book where it takes place in the same place at the same, one after the other. My books tend to dart all over the place in different centuries and different countries and now different continents. So, but can I write a second Ohio book in a row? Well, yes, why not? I love Ohio, and why not? And it was even the same century. But I think I decided it wouldn't be the same part of Ohio. So I started looking around, and I thought, I want Johnny Appleseed to be one of the characters, but not the main character. So where was he? And I had worked out for the later part of the book when I wanted that set, and so I looked back and I thought, okay, I want this family to move to Ohio in the late 1820s, early 1830s. And where could they move to? Well, not to here. This is where they wanted to come, Hudson. They wanted to come around here, the Western Reserve, but they get there, and it's full. It's full of all those Yankees who came out earlier, all those Connecticut veterans who came out and got their plot of land, and they end up having to go to the Black Swamp. Has any of you ever been to the Black Swamp? You have, so you've been to the nature reserves, because actually the Black Swamp doesn't exist anymore. But it's just south of Toledo. There was this big patch, which they drained in the 1860s, and all that's left now are nature reserves that remind you of what it would have been like. But it was settled last because it was the worst part of Ohio possible. It was so bad that people tended to want to pass through it. And my family, who are called the Goodenoughs, keep going west from here, and they end up getting literally stuck in the mud in the Black Swamp, and there they stop. It was very muddy. It was very isolated. It was hard to grow anything. It was full of mosquitoes. You'd get swamp fever every year, every summer, for between August and October. And I read a number of journals and letters from people at that time who were living in the Black Swamp, and it just sounded horrendous. And I thought, that's what I want. Yes, I want a really horrible part of Ohio to write about. So what I'm going to do is read two short sections by the man and the woman who are fighting over apples. And this is their feeling about apples and the Black Swamp. So this is in the 1830s, he's writing. James Goodenough stood in the melting March dusk and surveyed his orchard. 5 rows of trees with a small nursery of seedlings in one corner. It was rare to see space around individual trees in the Black Swamp. Normally, there was either open water or dense woods. The Goodenough orchard was not spectacular, but it was proof to James that he could tame one small patch of land, make the trees do what he wanted. Beyond them,
wilderness waited in the tangled undergrowth and sudden bogs. You had to take each step with care or find yourself up to your thighs in black, stagnant water. Now he counted his apple trees, even though he already knew he had 38. He had expected the requirement for settling in Ohio of 50 viable fruit trees in 3 years would be easy to achieve, but he had been assuming apple trees would grow in the swamp as they had done on his father's farm in Connecticut, where the ground was fertile and well-drained. But swampland was different, waterlogged, brackish. It rotted roots, encouraged mildew, attracted blackfly. It was surprising that apple trees could survive there at all. There were plenty of other trees. Maple was abundant, also ash and elm and hickory and several kinds of oak. But apple trees needed light and dry soil, or they could easily not produce fruit. And if they did not produce, the good enoughs must go without. The Black Swamp was not like Connecticut, where if your trees had blight or scab or mildew and grew no apples, you could barter or buy from neighbors. Here, neighbors were few and scattered and had no apples to spare. James Goodenough was a sensible man, but apples were his weakness. They had been since he was a child, and his mother had given him sweet apples as a special treat. Sweetness was a rare taste, for sugar cost dear, but an apple's tart sweetness was almost free, since once planted, apple trees took little work. He recalled with a shudder their first years in the Black Swamp without apples. He hadn't realized till he had to go without for over 3 years how large a part apples had played in his life, how he craved them more than whiskey or tobacco or coffee or sex. That first autumn, when after a lifetime of taking them for granted, James finally understood that there would be no apples to pick and store and eat, he went into a kind of mourning that surprised him. His desperation even drove him to pick the tiny fruit from a wild apple tree he came across along one of the Indian trails. It must have grown from a settler's discarded apple core. He could only manage three before the sourness forced him to stop, and his stomach ached afterwards. Later, over near Perrysburg, he shamed himself by stealing from a stranger's orchard, though he only took one apple, and it turned out to be a spitter rather than an eater. He ate it anyway. Now, this is Sadie Goodenough, his wife. "I never wanted to live in the Black Swamp. Who would? It ain't a name draws you in. You get stuck there, more like, stuck in the mud and can't go no farther, so you stay because there's land and no people, which was what we were looking for." James was second youngest of six healthy sons, so there weren't but a little bit of good enough farm in Connecticut for us. We managed for a time, but James kept reaching for me at night and the children kept coming. Then his father, an old killjoy, never liked me, started hinting about us moving west where we could settle more land. He got the wives of James's brothers to talk to their husbands, which they were glad to do because they didn't like me either. They didn't trust me around their men. I got something they didn't have. So the brothers started pushing James to be more adventurous than he was. Really, they should have gotten James's brother, Charlie, to go west. Charlie Goodenough was the youngest, and by tradition, he was the one should have gone. Plus, he had the gumption in him. Charlie wouldn't have let mud trap him in the swamp. He'd have bust through it and got out into the open where there's good, healthy land, solid under your feet, with sun and grass and clean water. But everybody loved Charlie, his wife most of all. It was she took against me the worst. Maybe she had reason to. Then all of a sudden, Charlie also said James ought to go, but he looked real sorry when we did leave. Stood longer than the rest, watching our wagon go down the long track away from the Goodenough farm. I bet he wished it was him beside me, heading towards a new life. Turns out lots of Connecticut farmers had gone to Ohio before us. Too many. We went across New York, then took a boat on the lake from Buffalo to Cleveland and started looking, expecting our pick of land to be laid out before us like a nicely made bed. but all we found were other Yankees. We made a circle round Cleveland, then heard we was better off going west to the Maumee River. After Lower Sandusky, we was heading toward Perrysburg when the road, if you can call it that, got worse and worse. That road was where we met our first enemy, mud. I never saw anything stick so much. It stuck to the wagon wheels, and when they turned, they collected more mud like a ball of snow getting bigger and bigger. Got so we had to stop the wagon every 50 feet to scrape it off. Near broke the horse's legs. Finally, they wouldn't budge, and we had to wait till they recovered. Next day, we got half a mile before they stopped again. Along that stretch of road, there were inns every quarter mile for all the travelers getting stuck. At last, we got to the Portage River and decided that was it. We couldn't go no farther, so it looked like we'd arrived at our promised land. By then, everything was covered in mud. We'd been wading through it and couldn't get it off our boots or out of our dresses or out from under our toenails. Sometimes the boys would take off their trousers at night, and in the morning they'd be standing up by themselves with the mud dried on them. Had to live with it and wash in the river. After a time, we got used to it. Maybe I just stopped caring. I'd hear new settlers complain about the mud and think, there's worse things than mud. Just you wait. We arrived in the swamp in early April, which is a good time to settle, except there's a rush to plant crops and a garden and build a house. And to do any of those things, you first got to clear the trees. They was another enemy waiting for us in the black swamp. Damn them trees. I hate them. God love me, I do. Back east, we didn't have the tree problem the way we did in Ohio. James and I both grew up on farms that had been made sometimes before, with houses and barns built and cleared fields and gardens. My mother even had flower beds. There had been settlers in Connecticut for 200 years, and they'd been the ones breaking their backs to dig up the trees. Every garden, every field, every churchyard and road had to be made by taking out the trees. Wasn't until we was faced with a slice full of Ohio trees that we realized how much work we had to do. There sure wasn't going to be any flower beds in the black swamp. Any clearing had to be done for a better reason than flowers. It was for feeding you and keeping you warm and dry. Clearing took so much out of my children that sometimes I think that's what killed Jimmy and Patty. Weakened them so the swamp fever got them that much easier. Patty died the first summer, Jimmy the next. I never forgave the trees for that. And never will. If I could, I'd gladly burn down these woods. I heard there's land out west that's got no trees on it at all. Prairie. Lord, send me there. I tried to talk to James about going there, but he wouldn't listen. Said we made a place for ourselves, hunkered down like toads in the stinking, rotten swamp, and here we'll stay. So that's their life. In the black swamp, and it doesn't go well, as you can imagine. They are quite the dysfunctional family, and in a way, this is a book that's an antidote or an antithesis to some of the more romanticized pioneer stories we get. And I started thinking, what would it be like to have a couple who actually don't get along when you're under such difficult circumstances and you're isolated and one of you becomes addicted and is quite narcissistic, then what happens? And how does that affect your whole family? So the Goodenoughs have 10 children and it gets whittled down to 5 by swamp fever. But one of those children, Robert Goodenough, who's 9 at that part of the story, he's the one who makes it to California. And in a way, this book is about a love of trees and a movement of trees between different parts of the world and of people moving across. And in particular, the American tendency to move west when you're looking for a new life, when you're trying to get away from what's gone wrong and looking for that American dream, which I think in a way grew up during the gold rush of 1849 onward, that California became the place that was where you could remake yourself. And whether it was actually true or not is out for the count, but But that was the myth that grew up, and this is a book that explores that myth. So there are two parts of the book, the part in Ohio in the Black Swamp with James and Sadie, and then the part in California with Robert. But there's a kind of lacuna between the two, because Robert leaves Ohio when he's 9 years old, and we then meet up with him again in California when he's in his 20s. But I didn't want you to wonder what happened to him during all that time, what happens to a little kid when they set out on their own like that. So I didn't want to write a saga. I didn't want to write a really door-stopping book. I'd never do that. But I thought, well, I'll fill all that space with letters from him. Robert writes back to his family in the Black Swamp every year on January 1st. And I'm going to read you a series of letters over those years from him. He starts when he's 9, so you can't see it on the page, but his spelling is atrocious, and it gets a little bit better as time goes on. So this is every year, and I won't read the same address every year, but the address changes when he moves. And also, keep in mind, when you write a letter back then, and this is 1840, it can take months to reach, and it may never get there. You just never really know. It's nothing like what we live through now, so very different. Smithson Ferry, Kingsville, Canada, January 1st, 1840. The Goodenoughs, Black Swamp, Portage River, near Perrysburg, Ohio. Dear brothers and sisters, this is your brother Robert. I have learnt my letters. The captain of the boat I'm working on Lake Erie taught me. Now the lake is froze, I am at Kingsville in Canada. I hope you are all well and the fever did not take anyone this year. You can write to me, I wait for a letter. Your brother, Robert. Winston Hotel, Detroit, Michigan, 1841. Dear brothers and sisters, it is 1 year since I wrote. The boat I worked on broke in a storm and I am not on the lake anymore. Detroit is all right. I am washing bottles in a hotel. How are everyone? How are the apple trees? Martha, if you still know your letters, you can write me at the Winston Hotel, Detroit. Your brother, Robert. Terre Haute, Indiana, 1842. Dear brothers and sisters, greetings and happy new year. I've learned my letters better from Mr. Jonah Parks, who I travel with now in a wagon selling medicine. I work with him as Detroit had too many people. We are mostly on the road going town to town. I like it. It suits me better than a city. Maybe you've written me at the hotel like I said last year, but I had no letter. Do you know, I saw John Chapman once. I asked him for news of the family and the farm, but he said he did not go to the Black Swamp anymore. He is mostly in Indiana. That was a shame, for I would like news of the family. Mr. Parks is a good man, and if you write to almost any town in Indiana, he will get the letter. Except Lafayette and Bloomington, where he would be arrested, so do not write there. Your brother, Robert. Gilbert Hotel, Racine, Wisconsin Territory, 1844. Dear brothers and sisters, I am sorry I did not write last year as I did the other New Year's, but the law caught up with me and Mr. Parks, and I was in jail. When I got out, I went farther west and Wisconsin, where I work in a hotel stables looking after horses. It is good because the horses keep me warm at night, as the winters are very cold in Wisconsin, colder even than the Black Swamp. I have not been here yet in the summer, but they say there are not so many skeeters. How is the farm? Sometimes I recall the golden pippins. I miss the taste. You can write me here at the hotel. I would like a letter. Your brother, Robert. Rancho Salazar, Texas, 1849. Dear brothers and sisters, I am writing on New Year's Day from Texas, where I've been working on a ranch now for almost 2 years. I did not mean to come here, but fell in with a rough bunch, and it was hard to get away. We came down the Santa Fe Trail and got work on a ranch run by an old Mexican. It is steady work but hard, and I do not like cattle much. They attract too many flies. Also, the land is a desert, very hot, and no trees. We are far away from anyone, so I can't give an address where to write, which is a shame, for I would like a letter. I am all right, but when I make enough money, I am going to California. A man here has been there and told me about trees called redwoods that are 300 feet tall and it takes 20 men, arms stretched round, to circle it. I did not believe him, but I want to see for myself. I miss trees. Also, there's gold in California, and that is a temptation. I hear you can make $200 a day gold mining, where here I make $5 a month. I will write again from California when I have an address to write to there. Do not forget me. I have not forgotten my family in the Black Swamp. Your brother, Robert. Miller General Store, Nevada City, California, 1851. Dear brothers and sisters, Happy New Year to you all. I am in California mining for gold. I have found plenty, but not made much money because it is so expensive to live here. The minute I am paid for my gold, I pay it back for supplies. Flour and bullets and oats and stabling all cost more than anywhere I've ever lived. I do not think I will be mining for much longer, as the gold fever does not suit me. Some men are taken over by it, and even when they have found gold, they are never satisfied. If you are going to write, send it quick, as I will not be here too much longer. Your brother, Robert. Greenshaw Hotel, Sacramento, California, 1853. Dear brothers and sisters, it is 2 years since I wrote. I left the mining because it breaks a man's spirit to chase gold. Now I'm working on farms and ranches, usually near Sacramento, but I go other places too. I saw the giant redwood trees. They are really something, very tall and straight and dark all among the smaller trees. I saw the ocean too. It is a little like Lake Erie, but the waves are bigger and the water tastes salty. The Greenshaw Hotel will hold any letters for me if you want to write. Your brother, Robert. Mrs. Bienenstock's Guest House, Montgomery and California Street, San Francisco, California, 1854. Dear brothers and sisters, Happy New Year, and I hope everyone is healthy, wealthy, and wise. I have had a good year because I met a man called William Lobb. He collects plants and trees and seeds and sends them to England, where they like California pines. I did not know there was work like that as a plant agent. That is what I am now. I am helping Mr. Lobb. We saw giant trees up in a place called Calaveras Grove. They are like redwoods, with their red bark, but even wider. I wish you could see them. You would be amazed at how big they are. The base of the trunk would fill the kitchen of the house in the Black Swamp. I think they must be the oldest trees on the earth. They made me feel small, but it was the best feeling I ever had, better than church or a good meal even. I move around a lot collecting seeds, but I always come back to San Francisco, and my landlady is good at getting letters to me wherever I am. I guess by now you've long forgotten me, but I have not forgotten you. Your brother, Robert. January 1st, 1856. Dear brothers and sisters, every New Year's Day I think about what to write to my family in the Black Swamp. Sometimes I do not write because it is too hard and takes so long. It has been over 17 years since I left the swamp, and I never had a letter back. I do not know if anyone is still alive, and so this is my last letter. I am still collecting seeds and plants for Mr. Lobb. He has taught me a lot, and I am very grateful to him. I will be all right here. I have a job working with trees, and that is better than I ever expected to do. I hope that you are all right wherever you are. Your brother, for the last time, Robert. Don't worry. Don't worry. Trust me. Do you think I'd write all those letters and not have there be a... Okay. Yes. So Robert talks about, refers there to redwoods and sequoias, and that's the other part, that's the other pole in the story, redwoods, sequoias in California. And I had the idea to write about them. I mean, I wanted to write about trees and have trees be almost like characters in a book. And partly this is because my husband is really into trees, and whenever we go for walks, he points them out, and he's now writing a book about trees, nonfiction. And I love it because he comes into the room and says, "Writing's so hard." Like, welcome to my world. Yes, indeed. But years and years ago, 25 years ago I think it was, we went walking in along a path called Offa's Dyke, which is just between Wales and England. And somebody along it said to us, "Do you know there's a grove of redwoods along here that was planted. There are 33 of them planted in 1857 by an eccentric Englishman. So go have a look, and we did, and they're beautiful. And the crazy thing is, in California and Oregon and Washington, coastal redwoods only grow in very particular conditions. So you don't see them. Well, you don't see them all over America, but they seem to grow in Britain beautifully. Maybe it's because of all the rain. So in the Victorian times, there were gardeners who, particularly wealthy people who had big estates and wanted to plant unusual things. They wanted different plants from what they had normally had. So the nursery started sending out these plant collectors, and two of them were William and Thomas Lobb, brothers from Cornwall, and one went to Asia and started collecting things like orchids. And William Lobb went first to South America, sent back stuff, and then to North America. And at that time, the Victorian gardeners were saying, right, we mostly have deciduous trees in our gardens, so the leaves fall in the winter and there's nothing there, but we have very few indigenous conifers, evergreens. So bring back some evergreens. We want some of those Californian pines, so ponderosa, sugar pine, Monterey pine, all those pines. William Lobb started sending back both seeds and saplings. And then he started sending back redwoods. And then he heard about these giant sequoias, which were discovered by white people anyway. Native Americans knew about them for a long time. But in 1852, they were discovered by a man who was out hunting a grizzly and came upon these massive, they're the really huge ones. Like the coastal redwoods are the tallest trees. And the sequoias are those ones that you can drive the car through. And in fact, at Calaveras Grove, where they were first discovered, one of those trees fell recently. You may have seen in the paper. And it was one of the trees that had a thing cut out of it so that carriages could go through it about over 100 years ago. And it's quite amazing it lasted as long as it did, but it blew down in a storm. And so William Lobb heard about these, and he went to look at them. And he was so amazed by their size and how beautiful they are and how unusual they are that he gathered saplings and seeds and he accompanied those on a ship back to England himself. And people, it took their fancy. Even though it was going to take 1,000 years for them to grow that big, Victorian gardeners started planting them. And the crazy thing is, next time you go to England, have a look around and you'll see both sequoias and redwoods in various places, especially in places like, if you think of Downton Abbey, that sort of estate, you'll find, that's where you'll find redwoods and sequoias. And I found this amazing, and particularly as an American who has emigrated to the UK, I realized that actually trees move around with people. So people move, lots of English people, British people came over to settle in the States, and they brought with them apple trees. You know, apple trees are not even native to America. That's what's so crazy. They actually come from Kazakhstan. So they came along the trade routes through Persia, and the Romans brought them eventually to Britain, and the British brought them over here. So they plants move around just the way people do. They sort of follow people. People bring them. And not only one way, but the other. So here you have apple trees coming in from Europe, and then you have conifers, of all things, going back to England. Fascinating. I loved it, and I thought, I want to parallel the trees and the people in this book. So that's why I have two states and two different types of tree and two real people. So Johnny Appleseed is the tree man in the East, and William Lobb is the tree man in the West. I'm going to finish by reading a short section when Robert first comes across the sequoias himself. Robert Goodenough was working in a field north of Sacramento when he first heard about the giant trees. He and a handful of other men were raking up hay ahead of a summer storm that growled way in the distance but never seemed to get closer. It was just one of dozens of jobs Robert had taken since quitting gold mining 2 years ago. He didn't mind the sun on his back, the sweat stinging his eyes, the endless repetition of the same movement. Life was often simply the repetition of the same movements in a different order, depending on the day and the place. What he could not stand was the constant chatter of the man raking to his right. Hours of dull stories about the gold he had found and drunk away, or the high prices to be paid for anything in California, or the trials he'd had on the overland trail to get here from Kentucky. These were all familiar tales to Californians, only enlivened by an unusual style of telling or a twist in the tale. The raker had neither of these. Robert gripped his own rake harder and harder to keep himself from punching the man to shut him up. Then the raker commented, "I'm going to get myself back to Kentucky one of these days real soon. I had enough of California. Seen all there is to see. Seen the biggest gold nugget in the world weigh 23 pounds. Seen the ocean, didn't think much of it. Seen the red trees nice and tall, but I miss hickory and dogwood and tulip trees back home. I don't need to see more. I'm done here." "Bet you ain't seen the big trees over at Calaveras County," said the man working on the other side of the raker. "Now, those are some trees. Take your average redwood and triple it across. That's how big they are." Robert paused in his raking. "Is that by the Calaveras River?" "Nah, up the Stanislaus River ways. Up in the hills. But there aren't redwoods up in the mountains. You only find them on the coast." The man shrugged. Robert fixed him with his bright brown stare that he knew rattled people. "You actually seen them?" Now the man frowned, annoyed to have his authority questioned. "Heard about them from somebody when I was in Sacramento. The only trees I need to see are the dogwoods next to my daddy's farm," the raker interjected. "Them's the prettiest trees you ever saw in the spring. I got me a pain just thinking about them." Robert took up his rake again and pulled the hay into a pile that would eventually grow into a haystack. He asked no more questions, for he had no interest in pursuing rumors about giant trees that had actually been verified by eyes on trunks. Yet the man's words stayed with him. When the harvest was done and it came time to move on, Robert did not go north or west to look for work, but headed south and east, reaching the Stanislaus River without even acknowledging to himself that this was his destination. He began to follow it into the hills towards its source, and soon the rumor was substantiated. "There are giant trees, all right," a man who worked for the Union Water Company told him. "Found by a hunter supplies meat to the company. Was chasing a grizzly up there and came upon a grove of the biggest trees anybody'd ever seen. He's dined out on that story for the past year. Thought everybody had heard about it by now. Where have you been?" As he got closer to Calaveras Grove, talk grew louder and louder until it seemed every person Robert met couldn't wait to tell him about the mammoth trees. It was strange that nobody had actually taken the time to go and see them. But then Robert knew others didn't care about trees in the way he did. Finally, he reached Murphy's, a mining town about 15 miles from the grove, and there found someone who had visited the trees. The man said little about them. "Gotta see for yourself," he explained. "I can't describe them." In the morning, Robert saddled his horse, an unpredictable speckled gray he'd bought off a miner. He hadn't named the gray and wasn't sure he ever would, since naming something tied you to it made it more painful to lose. When Robert arrived at the edge of the grove, he dismounted and stood, hand on his horse's neck anchoring him. In his travels, he'd seen many things that had given him an ache deep in his chest, like a splinter of sadness needling into his heart. Prairie that swept far out of sight. A tornado cycling across the gray-green horizon. Snow-covered mountaintops that hung overhead like white triangles. Now he was seeing another. Two enormous trees stood on either side of the track, a natural entrance to the wood beyond. They were not as tall as redwoods Robert had seen on the coast, but they were much wider, as wide at their bases as a cabin. They dwarfed a person with their girth and the volume of wood they thrust towards the sky. If you stood far enough back to take in the whole of the trees, you didn't feel how enormous they were. If you came up close, though, you couldn't see their lowest branches. Robert left the gray and walked up the path, feeling as he did that he was shrinking into a speck beside the two trees. He put a hand on one to steady himself. The tawny red surface was spongy and thickly fissured, a fibrous bark that shed easily and turned into red dust Robert later found in his clothes and his hair. The forest floor around the trees was thick and springy with thousands of years of rotting needles muffling his steps, and it was quiet, for there were no branches anywhere near him to rustle in the wind. Branches only started to grow from about 100 feet up, and the bulk of them were so high over his head that it strained his neck to look at them for long. Robert had no words for the odd, hollowed-out feeling that swelled inside him. Thank you. So you really need to see those trees for yourself if you haven't, because they are spectacular. And you can see them. There's also Sequoia National Park further south, and there's some in Yosemite as well. They're really wonderful. And come to England and have a look at them. A lot smaller and younger, but they're still there. Now, I'm happy to take questions from anybody who has any.
And there's a few, because we want to get into the rotunda, so maybe two or three, maybe four.
Well, we'll see. I'll say them out so that you can hear them for those who can't. Yes, anyone? She scared you. You just be quiet. Yeah, you ask.
Yeah. Kind of the main character almost. What comes first, the artwork or kind of the time period or story?
Okay. The question is, some of my other books that are about artwork, does the artwork come first or does the time period come first? The artwork comes first. And in fact, it's not just art. Usually something comes first before the time period. I never choose a time period first and think, what story can I tell around it? So it can be a painting I've looked at, or a set of tapestries, or it can be a cemetery I walk around, or a story about an apple tree, the story of a fossil hunter in early 19th century England. And it's the fact that it's the woman and her story, or the painting and its story, rather than the place itself. I think it'd be a kiss of death if I sort of thought, okay, I want to set something in Italy in the 14th century because I really like Italy. Actually, I would love to do that, but I can't. And I've often thought I'd really love to write an Italian book, but I can't go at it that way. I can't think, okay, I'm going to set something in Italy. Let me look around till I find a story. It's always the story first, and the history is secondary. There was, yes.
Can I follow up on that?
Yeah. Sure. The question is about the historical research I do and whether I enjoy it and how I do it. I love it. I think I could always just do research and then never write it, because the writing is really hard. And it's always easier to read something somebody else has written and take notes on it than to write my own original. But if I didn't write, if I wasn't planning to write something, then I wouldn't have any reason to redo the research. So it goes hand in hand. I spend a lot of time at the British Library. I'm not just on the Board of Trustees, but I actually use the library a lot. So I get out a lot of books, and so it's a concept. So with At the Edge of the Orchard, I read a lot about Johnny Appleseed first, and then about settlers in Ohio, and then history of the Black Swamp, and then I read about the gold rush and the move out there. And then, but then there came a point where I had to go out. First of all, I had to start eating a lot of apples. So I learned a lot about apples. And then I came here, of course. I spent, although there's not a lot left of the Black Swamp, so it wasn't like I spent weeks there. I spent days wandering around, and I went to Sauter Village, which is just west of Toledo. It's a sort of setup of 18th and 19th century dwellings and stuff. Pardon? Archibald, Ohio, thank you. And it was that was really useful. And so I always go to the place, and there's just something about being there in the countryside, in the wherever it is, and just taking in the sun and the sounds. And even though it's 21st century now, I can, if I squint, I can kind of get rid of all that. And it's there's just a feeling I get that I could never get when I'm just at home. So, for instance, the sequoias, when I visited them, things like the fact that around the base of them there is literally 1,000 years of pine needles makes it incredibly springy and quiet. because it absorbs a lot of sound, and I just wouldn't have worked that one out if I hadn't been there. And the other thing is I watched people as they approached the trees, and they'd always go up to them and put a hand on it and then look up. So it's like they're steadying themselves. And so I had Robert do that because that was what, but I wouldn't have thought of it myself in my room. So that's, it's a combination of reading a lot and talking to experts, but also going to those places. And in some instances, like with The Last Runaway, it was about the main character is a quilter, and I learned to quilt myself so that I could write about that more successfully. And so it's a whole different, a lot of different strands of research. Yes, in the blue, yeah.
Best apple in the world.
Okay, two things. The one question was when was the Black Swamp drained? In the 1860s. And the other comment is about the Evercrest. Now, you've just like touched a nerve that I, ooh. Okay, so one of the little pet peeves that drives me crazy is that we eat about four different varieties of apple now, and that's it. And there are literally hundreds of heirloom apples and varieties, both here and in England. And I love seeking those out. And Evercrisp, I think, is one of the new ones. Is it different from Honeycrisp?
Yes.
Okay. So I don't like really sweet apples. I like them to have a bit of character. Is it really sweet?
It's really sweet. I feed it to my grandchildren.
Yeah. No. Okay. So
it's
okay. Right. I'll give it a try, but I'm not. I'm a little skeptical, and I have to say, in a second, sir. In Robert at one point in his letter mentions the golden pippin, and that was it later got called a Pitmiston pineapple. And they're tiny, they're about that big, and they're yellow with brown spots, and the finish, they aren't that sweet. They're sweet enough, but the finish, the last taste you get is a pineapple. And they're so amazing. You can't find them commercially. It's only individuals who grow them, and I've planted one of those trees for myself, so in a few years I'll have them. Yeah. Sir, you wanted?
Yeah, speaking of metaphor.
Yes.
Did you do anything in your book with the sequoias need?
Yeah, oh, you know, the question is, did I use the metaphor of the sequoias needing fire in order to germinate, propagate? I didn't use it. I think I mentioned it in it, but just literally that he finds this out. I didn't use it as a metaphor, but it is quite amazing. And one of the the seeds of sequoias, the cones of sequoias, only open up and let out their seeds if they're heated. And that's why the forest fires are actually good for it, for sequoias, because it heats them, and it also clears the brush away and also creates a lot of carbon, which is good for the planting. So the forest fires that we're so desperately trying to put out sometimes are actually what they need. And in Yosemite, when we were there a couple of years ago, they were doing controlled forest fires because they said, the problem for sequoias now is that they're not propagating because we're so successful at stopping forest fires. So they now have to do these controlled fires. It's like that's exactly what happens when humans start there's so many of us, and we start thinking we're doing the right thing, and then it's all really balanced out. So yes, but that's one of the strange ironies is that a sequoia needs fire in order to germinate and propagate. Yes. The question is, loving history as I do, have I ever done my own genealogy and family history, and have I found any stories in that? I have done my genealogy of the Chevaliers. It was easy because my father was born in Moutier in Switzerland, and my grandparents were Swiss, and the Chevaliers had been there since 1574 because they were Huguenots who fled religious persecution from southern France. And this is starting to sound familiar to anybody who's read The Virgin Blue. So that That's not really what happened to my family in the Virgin Blue, but I use the period and the idea behind it. I haven't found any stories, not that I'm willing to tell you anyway. Though what was hilarious is we were over, looking, I'd forgotten about this. I was with my cousins and my aunt, my elderly aunt, who is very prim and proper and didn't like reading my stories if there's any sex in them. So that was a little tricky. And she, we were over in Switzerland looking up stuff in the archives. And after several of the children, this is probably mid to late 19th century, some of the children, it was written in French afterwards, illegitimate. So they had clearly had kids before they got married, and my cousin said, oh, we mustn't tell Lily, she'll be horrified. And, but that was very common back then, but I haven't found anything else. But I do have a pretty complete family tree that actually somebody else did, and I happened to stumble upon it. So, yeah, we have quite a lot of it. I think I have time for one last question, Gwen. Yes, make it good. It's the last one.
What's your writing method? How do you write?
What's my writing method? How do I write? I write with a pen and paper because I like it. I like it. And I, the end of the day, so my son goes off to school and I start writing. I look at my email and then I leave the computer and I go downstairs or someplace else because I can't write in the same room with it because I get tempted and start checking things. So I write in a notebook and at the end of every couple of days I type that into the computer so I have it on file. And then once I finished a draft, I'll print it out and correct on, you know, edit it on paper, and then I put the corrections in, and I go through several drafts. It usually takes me a good year to do a first draft, if not more, and then between the first and second draft is probably the most radical kind of changing, pulling apart, putting back together, but each draft is sort of like, I liken it to sandpaper that gets finer as you go on, and then there's the last burnish, so that's what I do, really. I think I might end on by telling you what I'm doing next. That might be a good way to. So very unusual. Usually it takes me 3 years to write a book. And this time, I actually have a book coming out in May. It's an unusual project. It's called The Shakespeare Project by a publisher who has asked various writers like Ann Tyler and Margaret Atwood and me to choose a Shakespeare play and then write a novel inspired by it. So I chose Othello, and I've set it on an American school playground in 1974, and they're all 11 years old. And it all takes place over the course of one day in the playground for the most part. There are adults, but you don't hear them that much. It's mostly the kids. And I think it took me so little time because, I wanted it to be short. It's really short. And two, the story was already supplied for me by Shakespeare, thank you, and also I didn't have to do research because I was 11 in 1974, and it was incredible not having to do research. It was kind of wonderful. As much as I like research, it was fantastic just thinking up, you know, all the candy I ate and the clothes I wore and the playground chants, the double dutch chants we used to chant when we were doing double dutch, and how you play jacks and what songs were on the radio, all that stuff. I just sort of remembered it. Oh, it was wonderful. So it was kind of what I call a palate cleanser. It's like, it's not the big main meal, but it's called New Boy, and it's out in May. And then now I'm working on my next historical novel, which is going to be set at Winchester Cathedral in the early 1930s, and it's about a volunteer group of embroiderers who embroider cushions and kneelers for the choir in Winchester Cathedral. And they still exist. You can see them and sit on them and everything. But it's about the petty politics of a volunteer group. So we all know what that means, yes. And that's set against the wider rise of fascism in the 1930s. So give me a few years and I'll be with you. Yeah. Anyway, thank you so much. It's been a pleasure. Thank you.